Ocean Connector event. As some of you know, Jim Hamlin is sailing the seas in the sunny Caribbean, so you are stuck with me tonight instead. My name is Sherry Scully. I'm the Director of Learning and Organizational Development at the IORE. And I will be your moderator for today's event. I would also like to welcome those of you who are joining us today via webcast. Sorry, we're working two different mics here and just trying to make sure one isn't interfering with the other. So we do have some people joining us on webcast. Unfortunately, I can't see who's out there, but I will invite them to submit their questions or comments via chat once we get rolling here. As you know, today's event is slightly different in format in that we're taking a student focus today. We've invited experts from the ocean sciences and technology industry to our panel to speak about related career paths and what they entail. There we go, that's better. We will have a few minutes of time with each individual to describe a little bit about their career, about the path and some of the decisions along the way. And they will also be providing some advice on other things that you might want to consider if you are interested in a career in their particular industry. And after each panelist has been introduced and had a chance to speak, then we'll break into a Q&A session. So please do hold your questions or comments until that time. Please also bear in mind that this is not a job fair, but it is a great opportunity to gain some mentorship and some career advice from experts working in your fields of interest. So let's go ahead and get started. First, I'd like to introduce Mark McIntyre from Corvaxium. Mark received his BSc in engineering from Dalhousie in 1977, followed by a BEng in electrical engineering from Nova Scotia Technical College in 1979. After working 2 years, he returned to University of Waterloo and completed a master's in science in 1983 and a PhD in electrical engineering in 1986, working on control and estimation theory. For the first 20 years of his career at Defence R&D Canada, Atlantic and Dartmouth, he focused on the data and information management aspects of undersea surveillance. In today's vocabulary, this would be known as the big data problem for sonar decision makers. In 1999, Mark switched research fields and moved to DRDC Ottawa, where he helped establish the newly formed Information Operations Section, dealing with information and network security for the Department of National Defense. This was long before cybersecurity became a hot topic that it is now. Mark returned to DRDC Atlantic in 2005 and was working on above water aspects of maritime security and situational awareness until he retired in January of last year. However, he's been unsuccessful at retiring as he continues to be fascinated by the expanding and evolving roles that the military are expected to play in the complex global and regional security environment that they find themselves in. He's now working with several companies and research organizations, helping identify areas for future R&D in marine security. Please join me in welcoming Mark. So that's for the web.
This is the web, this is the room? Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Sherry, and it's been a while since I've used a mic for anything, but please bear with me. And yeah, Sherry gave us some sort of general guidance as to what sorts of things to cover, and a short blurb on our career and sort of general guidance as to what you might be interested in. So I'm here speaking for, I guess, the defense and security community.
I spent my whole career working for Defense R&D Canada, which is an organization that has labs across Canada and one here in Dartmouth. But I'm not, it's not the only organization, sort of or federal research lab. National Research Council is another one, and they actually have a growing presence in defense and security. Communications Research Center up in Ottawa is another one, and there are others as well. Those are three that have a defense and security presence. So what I'll do is, Sherry asked us to do three things, kind of give an overview, so I'll expand just a little bit on what Sherry just said, although I'd forgotten I wrote that, and that's pretty well self-explanatory. And then she asked us to say, well, what actually drew me to a career in defense and security to try to give you a flavor for what you might be interested in. And then finally, to give some some sort of general guidance in careers, but in focused specifically on defense and security. So I guess, I'll just quickly walk through. I was really lucky back in 79 to, I graduated from what was then Nova Scotia Technical College. I had a bachelor's in electrical engineering. And at that time, the Defense R&D Canada, it wasn't called that then, they were having a difficult time getting people with masters and PhDs to get in the research world. So they hired a number of people with bachelor's degrees, and they were going with the intention of giving them the opportunity to take leave without pay in the future to go back. And that's exactly what I did. So I worked for 2 years, and then I took leave without pay for a number of years to go back to the University of Waterloo. And just in retrospect, that was really, it was very, very useful to have those 2 years to kind of set the stage for graduate studies. And so I was lucky to be able to do that. So from, again, that was 79 to about 1999, that was, I spent my whole career doing essentially sonar work. And what drove that was, I'm not sure how many people are aware, but undersea surveillance, essentially trying to find submarines, was really the number one mission for all of the Canadian forces for many, many years. And in fact, that's one of the reasons I decided to take the job at DRDC, because of the interest. And so that was the first 20 years, but in their late 80s, even the early 90s, you could see things changing. And essentially I bottom dropped out of the undersea surveillance market, and I decided to make a big change in career and move up to DRDC Ottawa, where, as again, at the time they had identified cybersecurity as an important area, so I had that opportunity. It was really interesting to be able to do that. Now, we had a hard time convincing people at that time that cybersecurity was something they should be interested in, but we did. And then frankly, while I was up in Ottawa, September 11th, the events of September 11th, 2001 happened. And that was a real wake-up call for the defense community, and that's when the security entered the defense and security title, if you will. And they realized that, wow, the world really has, they knew the world was changing, but they didn't realize how much the world was changing. And so they realized that, you know, we've got to really, you know, change our game here. And frankly, they're still trying to do that. So I worked from there from till 2005, and I had the opportunity to come back down to DRDC Atlantic. I was a manager for a while. I was a manager for about 4 years, and actually that was a big challenge. It's a lot of work. I managed a section of about 25 people there, and then I was also what's called thrust leader for information operations, and that was there we oversaw funding for all across DRDC as well as some of the other government labs in information operations. We had a budget of, I forget, it's about $3 million a year that we oversaw. But it was a lot of work. And I wondered whether a career in management was really for me. And I had the opportunity to come back down to Halifax and work in marine security. And so that's what I did, 2005 until I retired last year. So so what drew me to a career in defense and security really was interesting and challenging work. And I'm really hoping that people that go into that field have the same opportunities I did, because I've had some really, really interesting opportunities. The first scientific cruise I went on back in 1980, I had the opportunity to listen to a Russian ballistic missile submarine in the North Atlantic. And it really gave you a sense of, okay, what I'm doing is really important. But you know what? And another thing, I watched, you know, defense has funded some really basic research innovations, GPS being one of them, the internet being the biggest one, I suppose, and I saw that evolution, and again, to have that opportunity was really great. But I think defense, while it was innovative, I think it is not as innovative as it needs to be, and it really needs sort of young, fresh minds like you folks to come in and look at, okay, where has the commercial world taken GPS? Where has the commercial world taken the internet and apply it back to their problems? So, and then, okay, number three, just general guidance for a career in defense and security. I guess one thing, takes just, if you are interested at all, I know sometimes defense and security turns turns people off, but take some time to at least look at what Canada does, because Canada does, you know, I think we play a really interesting role, and we've always, the old term, punched above our weight. We've always done that in the past, and again, I think there's some really challenging problems that they have to come to grips with. And then furthermore, Canada in the next 20 years is spending literally hundreds of billions of dollars re-equipping the military, both the Navy, which you're probably all familiar with the shipbuilding program here, and the Air Force and the Army, to equip themselves for these new missions. And a lot of that is going to be funneled into research and development. So I do think there are going to be opportunities. And if I just speak for DRDC, I know we've gone through a big period of downsizing, but part of that was, okay, they want to clear out some of the old deadwood, I guess like me, and make way for new people. So I believe that DRDC for sure, and perhaps even NRC and CRC, will be going through a bit of a hiring stint in the next year or two. That's only my belief, that don't take that as gospel at all. So other general guidelines, I think it's really important to spend your time knowing what to do. You learn how to do things in university and in school, but it's really important to understand what it is needs to be done, and that you sort of develop along your career. Learn how to write a research proposal. I think people in general know that a lot better than I did when I went through school, but it's really important. And finally, look for opportunities to develop your knowledge and skills in practical ways. So again, the opportunity I had to work for 2 years before and going back, that was invaluable. Any opportunity you can do that, I would encourage you to do that. So anyway, hopefully I didn't take too much more than 5 minutes. So thank you very much.
Oh, right. I'm gonna rip that off.
Great, thank you very much, Mark. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Vicky Swan from the Nova Scotia Department of Fisheries and Aquaculture. Dr. Swan is the Manager of Aquaculture Development with the Nova Scotia Department of Fisheries and Aquaculture. She earned her PhD in Pathology and Microbiology at the Atlantic Veterinary College in PEI. Her research has focused on parasites of aquatic organisms, and much of her work has tackled issues impacting the aquaculture industry. Her current role with the provincial government draws upon her scientific background and industry knowledge to develop and administer regulatory programs. Thank you, Vicky. Come on up. Give you that one. Other way. Thank you. Well, I kept it relatively short on the bio that I submitted so I could have a little bit to speak about today. First of all, I'd like to just say that I know that my intro says that I'm a government regulator, and I'm sure that all of you are sitting there thinking, wow, this is going to be very exciting. It's certainly not the, when we talk specifically about career path, this wouldn't have been the one that I would have identified for myself. One of the advantages that I have is the particular industry in which I regulate, and it's a dynamic one, and it's also an extremely exciting one. So although many would probably identify roles in government as rather dry, my role continues to be challenging and exciting. As far as how I arrived at this position, my initial pursuits in university were purely academic. I did really early stage in my biology program. I fell in love, and I fell in love with a critter. I fell in love with a parasite. And it was really that parasite that sparked my career path. I remember the first dissection that I did, and I know that, you know, this might not be the case with many people, but as I opened up fish and I saw an organism that was living inside that fish and living off of that fish, my interest was instantly sparked, and I spent the next couple of years in a master's program in which I only looked at this group of parasites. And so I think I would have been quite happy to continue kind of along that insular academic train. But what I did manage to do was I managed to squeak myself into a co-op master's, which provided me with a little bit of extra funding along with my research grants. And then it also forced me to get out there and see some of the applications of the work that I was doing. So that initial foray into an industrial-focused research program allowed me to see what I was doing in the lab having an impact on businesses, on government programs, and on, you know, I was able to really see work that I thought was just cool, really translating into industry-specific challenges within the aquaculture industry. From that point on, it really became, I realized that that's the type of work that I enjoyed. I enjoyed going out and identifying issues, looking at challenges and seeing how science could address those challenges. One other thing that I have the advantage of is the aquaculture industry. I think anybody who's even remotely involved with the aquaculture industry would agree there are no shortage of challenges in this industry. So it allowed me to then use my scientific skills to work more closely with industry. My PhD program built on that. It was designed specifically to address some industry-specific concerns. Every research program that I've engaged in since that time has had an industry component to it. So I've worked on programs that have really identified issues and then helped to either gain more information specifically about those issues, or in some cases, in the best cases, in the days that you really think that you're spectacular, resolve some of those issues. My current role is really a testament to the aquaculture industry in Nova Scotia. We're currently at a junction in Nova Scotia in which industry development is potentially going to contribute to the overall economy of the province. So because we're at a stage in which we can have new regulations, my background within both the scientific and the industry focus allows me to bring a lens to this role to both identify challenges that are currently experienced within industry, but also some of the potential solutions that might be out there for industry. There are a diverse number of career paths that are centralized around this industry. So even though I am a biologist, I certainly have interacted with many individuals that both work in the industry and with industry partners that have an extremely diverse background. So one example that I've noted that really kind of is a testament to how production can be, I guess, increased or supported from various different avenues is there's currently a sea lice control mechanism. So typically sea lice are controlled with treatments, on-farm treatments that are, you know, traditional, have been used for many years. Recently, there's some groups that are looking at laser removal of sea lice. So people really within the aquaculture industry, because it's such a new food production system, there are many innovative solutions to industry challenges. So because of that, there's an attraction of very diverse backgrounds to the industry. For anybody who's interested in I guess, becoming more involved. I would say that some of the key features that I've noticed that are across all of these diverse backgrounds are really interest in problem solving, and also a knack to not give up on certain issues. I find that lots of people who are engaged in this industry tend to have the fortitude to stick with a program and keep innovating and keep moving to the next situation. Thank you. Okay. Thanks very much, Vicky. And thanks also for describing the job as well in terms of competencies, because education is certainly one part of it. But when we're thinking about our careers, we also need to be thinking about the interests and how those interests align with you know, how you spend a lot of your day in that particular job. I also thought it was a very interesting start to your career. And I will say that I lived in East Africa for a few years back in my early 20s, and during that time I played host to several parasites, and I can safely say I didn't fall in love with any of them at that time. Our next panelist is Joe Hood from Geospectrum Technologies. And Joe is a software product manager for Geospectrum Technologies, Inc. He obtained a BEng from the Royal Military College in 1991, and his MSc in Acoustics and Oceanography, also from RMC, in 1998. After a 15-year military career as a Canadian Air Force officer, where Joe focused on maritime surveillance operations, R&D, and procurement, Joe began working in industry. He spent 4 years at MDA as their acoustic program manager, and then founded Acoustics in 2006. Where he followed his passion of delivering multi-use, high-value underwater surveillance systems to multiple user communities. Acoustics was acquired by Geospectrum in late 2014, and Joe is now working as part of a more diverse and larger team to progress their common vision of delivering cost-effective sonar-based solutions to a variety of customers. Geospectrum started in 1994. It's grown from their core specialization of customer, transducer, and hydrofoam development into a diverse company capable of delivering end-to-end sonar systems to defense, oil and gas, and environmental scientific customers, covering a wide variety of uses. Geospectrum now has experienced focused teams capable of advanced custom transducer, hydrophone handling, mooring systems, electronics, and now sonar processing software and data analysis development. I'm going to say, my PhD is in management and social psychology, not in science and engineering, so I know how Penny from the Big Bang feels right now. This highly cohesive team works together to understand their customer needs and deliver the leading edge solutions they require for their work. Please join me in thanking Joy for being here.
Oh, we're caught.
Mic number two.
There.
Hopefully that's still working. So, yeah, I had forgotten that we had sent in the bio, so I don't have to go through the first part of my notes. You've already got that. It was actually kind of interesting as to how I got to where I am, because I started out on the prairies. I never thought I would end up actually spending more of my time in Nova Scotia than I did on the prairies. Never intended to be in the Air Force. That just kind of happened. And so I guess one of the first things is take the opportunities that end up in front of you. You never know where they're going to lead you to. And I could go through my whole career and different things have popped up in front of me, which you might have rejected. But having taken it and make the best of it, I've actually ended up, I think, in a pretty interesting place. One of the first places I ended up after getting my degree was, I was seconded as kind of a replacement, a fill-in, whatever you want to call it, to defense research, and Mark was actually my first boss. I got a lot of interesting work there and did some really interesting things that made me want to go back. Had I found a way to get out of that fill-in job, I never would have had that opportunity. So that's just one example. One of the other things that Mark said that I want to reinforce is, I mean, doing the academic work is really interesting, But to get to where you want to go, especially as an engineer or in the hard sciences, you got to get the practical experience. And one of my real benefits was spending 4 years chasing submarines around during near the end of the Cold War when things were getting hard. The Soviets had managed to recruit a few spies. They figured out how to make the submarines quieter. Things were getting pretty difficult. Having done all of that before going back for my master's degree gave me a completely different perspective. And I actually ended up in a situation with my profs where there was a back and forth. I was bringing them knowledge and ideas and information, and they were giving me the academic knowledge that I needed to try and take that and move it to the next level. So it actually became more of a collaboration rather than just sitting in a classroom and listening like you might do when you do your bachelor's. I kind of took a windy path. I thought I was going to be working on computer architectures because of where I did my bachelor's degree. I thought I was going to be a navigator, which is what I did my training to do, but I ended up chasing submarines. I ended up taking a real interest in underwater acoustics. Again, one of those coincidental things that happened. It just so happened that my wrestling coach was a Navy officer who was interested in ASW, and every time he went off to a wrestling tournament, we'd be sitting in the back of the bus geeking out talking about sonar. I didn't know anything about sonar having grown up on the prairies. So again, these things will jump in front of you during your career. Take advantage of them. So I guess what drew me to the profession, I mean, besides all these things that just popped up in front of me, a lot of it comes out of curiosity and enjoying solving problems. And like Mark said, in underwater acoustics, even now, all the problems are far from solved. And the reality is we're trying to solve harder problems. We don't just want to chase half a dozen Soviet submarines around the world. We want to know where thousands of marine mammals are at any one time. And actually, you're going to hear about some of that, I think, from some of the other people on the panel. That's a hard problem. It's a big data problem. Just trying to get the sensors out there to get that information to bring it in and make good use of it, to actually turn it into something that we can make decisions on and do something to make our life better or make the world better, that's a hard problem. So there's lots of hard problems to be solved. And that's probably what attracted me to this and what's keeping me here. I haven't left it, even though, like Mark said, ASW kind of took a little bit of a downturn for a few years. I think it's on the way back up. I decided not to leave it because I figured when it came back up, I would be ready to go again. What do you need in my career? Mathematics, physics, logical analysis. I mean, that's the academic side of it. You need practical experience. You need the ability to be able to visualize the abstract. A lot of what we do, you can't see, you can't touch, you can't really feel out. So you have to try and find a way to put it in your head and understand it. And if you're one of those people that can do that, this is probably a good career for you. And then the other side of it is you need lots of practical experience. You could get everything right on the theory side, and it could be something as simple as a broken wire or a mooring system that's vibrating and adding noise to your data that ruins your day. And so one of the things I'll put a plug in for, and I know some people are looking at it now, as you finish your bachelor's degree, there's a one-year program at Nova Scotia Community College in OS&T. And the whole design of that program is to try and allow students to get some practical hands-on experience and understand the other parts. So let's say you became an electrical engineer, it exposes you to more of the mechanical issues, some of the biological issues, some of the practical issues of dealing with weather and high currents and all of the other problems that have confounded other experimenters and other developers in the past. You can kind of get a leg up by taking that program, and I see at least one person in the audience who took the program last year. So if you want to put your hand up, if you've got any questions, maybe you can go ask him what he thought of the program from the inside. So I think one of the other questions that Sherry asks is you know, what would help you stand out? And beyond, I guess, you know, being good at academics and being smart, which I'm sure I'm far from the smartest person in the room, is just being curious, just being willing to ask questions and challenge people and ask for answers. Being willing to challenge the status quo. Okay, well, you might have done it that way for 20 years, but we've learned new things, we've got better computers, things have changed. Maybe even an idea that wasn't a good idea 10 years ago is now a good idea because reasons why that was a bad idea have changed. So be willing to challenge those kinds of things. And if you think you're right, you know, push it a little bit. Be willing to investigate, and you know, you're not always going to be right, but you're not always going to be wrong. And I think potentially one of the other things that benefited me is the fact that I got a lot of different experience that I could pull together. So I started out in the military as an officer. I learned all kinds of things there, but one of the biggest things I learned is, you know, how we hunt submarines, so from the practical perspective. But then I ended up in the science community, I ended up in the engineering community, I ended up in business. I was able to start, grow, and sell my own business. I couldn't have done that without looking into all of the other aspects and actually being able to do things like just simply write a proposal. So even the English classes that most engineers hate can be of benefit. So I'll finish with that.
Thanks, Joe. That's great. I think a key point there from Joe's talk is around serendipity, that we can start with a plan for what our and a map for what our career is going to look like. But often it's really about taking advantage of the opportunities that come along the way, and how exciting that can be. Next, I'd like to invite Adam Mugridge from Lewisburg Seafoods. Adam graduated from Dalhousie's Marine Biology program in 2003 and started working with the Kennedy Group on the development of several new emerging fisheries, including hagfish, sea cucumber, and whelk. His role within the company has evolved over time, and he also now works with the management team on strategic and financial planning, team building, innovation, and special projects. Recent work has focused on the commercialization of marine plants, adding value to fish waste byproducts, development of a GIS program for harvesting operations and aquaculture. And the company was founded in 1983 by Jim and Lori Kennedy, forming the Kennedy Group of companies. It's grown from humble beginnings, servicing fishing vessels and baiting trawl in the once bustling fishing village of Lewisburg on Cape Breton's south coast. Since that time, the Kennedy Group now boasts substantial operations in six communities across eastern Nova Scotia, employing over 600 people. With revenues north of $60 million, the multi-species fisher, buyer, grower, processor, and marketer of sea products has become increasingly focused on creating unique quality products of a very diverse range of ocean resources. The group now processes and sells shrimp, ground fish, snow crab, lobster, mussels, and other non-traditional species. And in recent years, the group has grown to include aquaculture operations, clean tech and biotech ventures, and information technology initiatives. Please join me in welcoming Adam.
Well, hi everyone. I didn't prepare any notes, and I was told to plan on speaking between 1 and 5 minutes, so I'm going to shoot for one and see how that goes. So I've been with the Lewisburg Group of companies owned by the Kennedys for 9 years, and I find that one of the most interesting things that happens with my job is that when I tell people that I'm involved in the fisheries, they say, "Wow, there's still a fishery in Nova Scotia?" And very much so there is. There's a very vibrant fishery, and it's a lot different than how it used to be as well. As Sherry had mentioned, a lot of what I do, I have a background in marine biology, so what I started doing was working on the development of new fisheries. And from that, I guess over time, it grew into other roles involving, you know, planning within the company, planning the growth, planning the research and development, innovation, new projects. So I can say that it's never a dull moment, and there's always something new going on within our company. I guess to touch on some of the points that we were told to talk about why I got interested in marine biology. Quite honestly, I didn't know what I wanted to do when I was taking my marine biology courses. I knew that I grew up in rural Cape Breton on the Myra River. My background was a river, so I knew I liked doing that. But to go from that to a career, I didn't really know. So I just knew that I liked that. I had a passion for that, and so I followed it. How I got the position I have today, quite simply, I had graduated. I didn't have a job. I was living in Halifax. I wanted to move home to Cape Breton. And one day, lo and behold, on the job bank, there was a job posting for a marine biologist in Lewisburg. So that doesn't happen every day. I applied, and I got the job. And that was 9 years ago. I guess some advice, if I had any. One thing I would say would be... one thing I would say is have an attitude that you want to be constantly learning. Have an attitude where you want to take ownership of what it is you're doing. And if I could identify any opportunities for potential people in my field, it would be take on a challenge like it's your own, like you own it. People will recognize that, and people will see that if you're passionate about it, you're simply not just punching a clock 9 to 5, you can't wait until 5 o'clock to go home. There's lots of times where, I'll find myself, working evenings, weekends, because I want to, because I enjoy it. And I think if you find yourself in that position, I think you're doing something right. So you're doing what you like to do. I think that's key. One other thing that I'll end on is that as far as opportunities go, there seems to be, the hot topic of entrepreneurship. So within the ocean industry, within the ocean sector, there are tremendous opportunities. There are things that people haven't even thought of. I guess one thing to consider would be to do things for yourself, create your own business. It seems scary. A lot of times, where I grew up, you were taught, find a nice government job and park yourself there for a few years and ride it out. But there are other opportunities there, and I guess what I would end on is you can use your creativity, you can be innovative, you can see problems that exist out there, and you can see those problems as opportunities. And consider the entrepreneurship route and work for yourself. So anyhow, I'll leave it at that.
Okay, thanks very much, Adam. Our next guest is Mark Jollymore from Themco. After completing a degree in electrical engineering at UMB, Mark worked at several defense aerospace organizations. Mark moved to Themco after completing his MBA and worked in various positions before becoming CEO in 2012. Themco fish tracking and monitoring equipment enables researchers to study the behavior and migration patterns of thousands of marine and freshwater animals over months and years and across vast distances. With tens of thousands of receivers deployed worldwide, Themco is the industry leader in providing acoustic telemetry products for fish research. Please join me in welcoming Mark.
Thank you very much. me perhaps more than anyone else is a case study in how little control you're going to have over your career. If you squint and shake your head just right, you can kind of put a patchwork together through aerospace into fish tracking, but boy, it takes a lot of imagination. I will cycle back because it does touch on one topic I want to talk about, and that's adaptability. Talked a little bit about opportunity and whatnot, but I'm going to put a kind of a different slant on it in terms of adaptability in a little bit. I think for Vemco, it's a small business that actually evolved out of the university, both UNB and Dalhousie here, through a sequence of small business startup and mergers and acquisitions to become a reasonably sized business. We've got maybe around 100 people employed out in Bedford, and we're doing business in 50 plus countries, let's say. So it's really, really grown in scope. For the skills, I think there's it's really good advice about skills that organizations in the ocean technology sector look for. But one of them that I really want to talk about is adaptability. Whether you're coming in through the biology, science, engineering, whatever stream you are coming in from, you've established a reasonably good track record of having an ability to learn, to problem solve. And once you get into the ocean technology sector, unlike things like aerospace, where you can actually do an aerospace engineering degree, Joe talked about the Nova Scotia Community College program, which I think is very positive. But many of the problems you get into in the ocean technology sector, you'll be standing on the shoulders of others who have solved similar problems, but mostly you'll be breaking new ground. It'll be very, very challenging for you, both in terms of just technical ability, which means that you're going to show up to your work every day and probably have a new challenge, have a different look at the industry. But there'll also be a lot of your success factor will be dependent on really the ability to solve a problem methodically. Problems in the ocean technology sector are very expensive ones. If you have a mistake or if you have a failure in there, it's going to be expensive at the end of the day. The other thing about adaptability that I wanted really to talk about was really on a very individual level as you enter the sector. The demands of the ocean technology sector, because you're dealing with different problems day to day, mean that you're really going to have be applying that problem solving outside of your particular expertise. If you come in through a biology stream, for instance, or a science stream, you're probably also going to have some level of ability I guess we talked a little bit about experience in other disciplines, mechanical engineering, battery powered type things, chemistry, materials, those sorts of things. And I think that's one of the real strengths that the community college program is bringing, is a very multidisciplinary view of what's going on. In terms of advice, when you come into a business in the ocean technology sector, I'd say just look for the people who are the go-to people in the organization. Mostly they're going to be the gurus, people who have an awful lot of very specific knowledge, but also look to the people who the organization's sending out into the field to get in front of customers and to do the field work. Oftentimes they're different people, but there's an awful lot of knowledge inside those guys' heads. And if you can spring that loose, then there'll be a lot of opportunity for you. I think I'll end on that note. Really, touched on a bit of on adaptability, on the multidisciplinary aspects of the job, and I will also reflect what has been said here. I think in Nova Scotia, in this area in particular, Nova Scotia, the Atlantic provinces, there's getting to be a real critical mass of expertise, both from the universities, the government labs, and businesses here now, that the next 10 years, the next 20 years, will probably be a lot different than the last 10 and 20 years. There is going to be a lot of opportunity there. And we, I think we could easily be sitting on the cusp of some really, really big breakthroughs. Thanks.
Great, some inspiring words. Mark, thank you. And last but not least, we have Craig Hillis with us today. Craig joined JASCO in 2010 as a senior electrical engineer. His most recent role before joining the company was as a program manager and lead engineer, primarily concerned with system architecture, detailed electronic design, field testing, and customer service. Craig's career has progressed since he graduated from the Technical University of Nova Scotia in 1992 with a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering. He joined Hermes Electronics Limited, which is now Ultra Electronics Maritime Systems, and he worked on a wide range of projects, including sauna buoys, a project in which he redesigned the RF frequency control, modulation and amplifiers, the digital DIFAR sensor, and automated test equipment that would ultimately be released into production. Craig also helped develop digital towed arrays. As a principal electrical engineer for Naval Systems, he helped architect the passive array used in the UK surface ship torpedo defense SSTD system and create a detailed design of the data acquisition subsystem. I'm having another penny moment up here. Throughout his employment, Craig has developed new products and updated existing ones, including principal design work with the pseudo-Doppler radio direction finder. Craig also worked as a senior electrical engineer on wireless through-the-earth signaling systems. He helped design the magneto-inductive remote activation munition system receiver for the U.S. Army and served as the lead engineer on the magneto-inductive signaling device system for the U.S. Navy. Please join me in welcoming Craig.
Thanks. I didn't prepare anything. I'm a fill-in for somebody else from JASCO who is unavailable at the last moment. But I graduated, actually my first degree was in 89 from Dow in mathematics, but I wanted to do something practical, so I continued on to the electrical engineering degree. I was quite fortunate in 92 to actually get a job at Hermes. Not many in the class were finding them that year, but it was a great learning experience. I actually gave new engineers real problems to work on, not just shuffling paper. One of the biggest things is it's a multidisciplinary thing. And as several people here have touched on, you might graduate in electrical, mechanical, whatever, but when you're out working on a project, nothing is just mechanical, nothing's just electrical, nothing's just software. And to learn, not as an electrical to do the mechanical design, but what some of the limitations are, how the two electrical, mechanical, software, various things interface with each other, what the trade-offs are, what you could do in the electronics to help the mechanical design, various things, the packaging, all of that to understand the other disciplines has always been very important. And then, you know, I bounced around. I realized I really didn't like the project management. I want to be hands-on designing, fought to get back to doing that. I wasn't ever really concerned which industry it was, as long as the design work was new and exciting. So I did the underwater acoustics at Hermes. I went and did radio direction finding, cell phone tracking, GPS tracking for law enforcement, through the earth, through the water signaling using magnetic signals, so wireless transmission for things like that. Then back into now the underwater acoustics again, this time from an environmental standpoint. We do the environmental monitoring for a lot of the various offshore projects and so forth to make sure they're in compliance or to do all the work ahead of time to find out what the ambient noise is, what marine mammals are where at what times, what their migratory paths are. I think last year we brought back somewhere between 30 and 40 terabytes of data to process. We have a fleet of probably 200 recorders or more that can go out and they autonomously record. You know, we can put up to 1.7 terabytes of memory on to bring back and process. We can stream real time. We've instrumented them with other things other than just hydrophones and put them on the Venus Array off on the West Coast, which is an underwater observatory. We've got two directional arrays out there. We actually use various products from some of the other people here. We've used VEMCO and Geospectrum products. So it's a very small, close-knit industry. Everybody ends up knowing everybody that works in it. But again, the biggest, I'll keep it short and let it open up for questions, but the biggest thing is to, well, first, make sure you enjoy what you're doing, because if you don't, you don't want to go to work every day and do it, and you're probably not going to do a very good job. So find something you enjoy, and you'll probably be, you'll do well at it. And the second thing is, just because you graduate in electrical, mechanical, chemical, when you get out there, you've got to open yourself up to saying, you know, I'm an engineer, and you've got to learn about how the other disciplines interact and see how all that works, because no system is just electrical, mechanical, software, or what have you. So I'll just close it out at that.
Okay, so now we're going to open things up here to questions. This is an opportunity right now, but this is very informal. My colleague David here has another mic, so if you have a question, just put up your hand and he'll come find you so that everyone can hear your question. And I'll actually repeat it because I have the mic for the webcast, and that way our colleagues and friends who are joining us remotely will be able to hear the question as well. So we'll open this up to questions. I will just say, if you have questions regarding specific projects that the panelists have been working on, maybe take that offline after the Q&A session. If you have questions specific to career development and the topic of discussion today, then we'd love to hear them. Who's going to start us off?
I've got a question.
Most difficult spot, right?
Mark. McIntyre there. When you were talking, you mentioned some, this is a little weird, I'm not used to speaking to a microphone, that there were past friends that you saw going through your career, underwater surveillance, cybersecurity, and I guess this extends to everyone as a question. What do you see the future trends going into as, like, this is what we're researching in, and by extension, potential skills or shortages that we're seeing in the area?
Can I pass the mic to somebody else on that one? That's a tough question, and it's one that we're kind of, well, I can't say we anymore because I retired now, but DRDC had been wrestling with that for a while, and historically, again, we were good at certain, you know, specific areas. We were good at designing, you know, sonar systems, or designing radar systems, or designing electro-optical, or, you know, things in space. But what I think there seems to be a real shortage right now of sort of people, again, that can bridge those things and say, okay, well, I don't just need a sonar system, or I don't just need a radar system. I need to look at this as more of a sort of an observation problem, information collection problem, and how I bring it all together. So I don't know that that's answered your question, but it's a challenge right now. What else can I say? There's lots of people asking the same question. and I have to say, in the defense and security world, I'm going to say this again, they're the people that brought us the internet and brought us GPS and brought us, you know, some other really fundamental things. But again, you folks have all experienced that. I mean, who doesn't use GPS? I mean, who can imagine a world without GPS or the internet right now? And you know, you have to bring your thoughts and just, you know, back to the defense community, the security community, to kind of really, they frankly, I'm going to say they need a kick in the butt. And they really do. They still spend lots of money, but they need to take advantage of some of the new ways of thinking. Anybody else would like to add to that?
I can add a little bit to that. One of the things that we all know is happening right now is there's a change in how we generate energy. especially things like oil. You think about how the Navy used to do business. I'm going to stick on the defense and security side. They used to take a whole fleet of ships and go out and do big jobs. You know, how do we fight World War III, basically, type of jobs? We don't have those kinds of jobs anymore. We don't have that kind of money. We don't have the kind of people that are interested in it. We don't kind of have the experience to do that. So it's introducing all kinds of challenges. Where do I think it's going to go? I think the trend is towards low power autonomous systems that can go out there and do a lot of the work for us. I mean, we're seeing it now on the air side with things like drones, but I think we're going to see that happen on the Navy side as well, where you might see one ship go out, deploy a bunch of drones, some of them might be underwater, they go off and gather information about the space and bring it back. I mean, the other trend, and this has been going on for years, I mean, even when I first worked with Mark in the early 90s, it was starting, and it's just gotten worse, is we have the ability now with new technology to produce reams of information. I mean, JASCO collects terabytes of data. Everybody collects terabytes of data. Well, how do you get information out of that so that you can actually make decisions? That's another challenge. So dealing with everything from how do I create computer algorithms that can process that stuff to how do I make sense of it and present it to an operator so that they can actually make a decision. And like I said before, the problems are getting harder. It used to be our concern was, you know, where's a submarine or where's a limited fleet of submarines? Now we're worried about the fishing boat or the cargo vessel that looks like every other fishing boat and cargo vessel that might be doing something he's not supposed to do. How can I go through all of the information that might be available from emails to AIS information to satellite photography to decide that that's the ship that I should be paying attention to? Those are really hard problems. And it's a multidisciplinary problem.
That's great.
I'm going to add one to that too.
Oh, sure.
I don't know whether it's because VEMCO is in such a niche area or not. There's two things that really show up on our radar for us. Specialty type education expertise, and that's first mechanical, whether it's technologist or engineering, somebody with the expertise and, quite frankly, experience to be able to build pressure vessels. It really comes down to that. It's a very, very unique capability. So I'm not sure that we're paying enough attention to our education system. Fill that need. The other thing is, if the variety of small businesses are successful around here, the other thing that we're going to need is product managers, people who can really mold the business side into technology to bring stuff to market.
Great. Thank you. Anyone else want to add anything to that? I also just want to remind people joining us via webcast, if you have a question, go ahead and send it in. Actually, there is one question here, so I'll go ahead and read it. From Michael Orr, a CBU student. Well,
it's okay, Michael, you're a CBU prof, we know that.
Here's a question. How do undergrad students learn about the problems that exist that need to be solved? And then he followed that up with the role of incubators in ocean technology, following the crowd, or a good place to start? Who would like to tackle that question? Everyone's jumping up to tackle that question. Michael, maybe you could let me know who you were addressing that question to. We'll see if he follows up. In the meantime, while we're waiting for him to follow up, did you want to? Great.
I can make a really quick comment on incubators, and that's just, if you look at kind of a lot of the strategic direction that's coming from above, that in government world, that means Ottawa, there is a lot of emphasis on, you know, how does industry work together with university, work together with government research lab potentially, and the notion of an incubator is something that's very, very strongly encouraged right now. So I think, I don't know if that answers the question from whoever submitted that. But.
Great, thank you. Thank you. What other questions do you have out there? In the back corner.
So a common theme that you guys kept saying is practical experience, but it seems that entry-level jobs you already need to have that practical experience to get those jobs. So how do you get practical experience to get those entry-level jobs?
And that is exactly one of the reasons why NSCC started that Ocean Tech program. The idea is to give you, through an extra year of education, I know the last thing anybody in the room here, if you're about to graduate, want to do is go back to school for another year. But the whole idea is to give you that hands-on experience so that you've got that leg up to get that job. Because you're right, it can be hard.
Anything to add?
I'd just say that I think the co-op programs that are now out there help a lot now. And when I went through, we didn't have co-op, but I was fortunate. I had summer jobs, two summers at Defense Research, two summers with the Department of Mines and Energy. So, you know, you can get some practical experience through that. Your design project, anything that you can actually show where you've actually done something other than just, you know, an assignment in class or your exam work can help. It's a matter of showing that you understand what's going on and how to apply things. So I think through your summer jobs and things like that, that's all valuable to show.
Great. Oh, one more thought.
I've had the opportunity, especially running my own business, to go through lots of resumes. And if I'm going to take your question and take it on a little bit of a tangent, the real question that you might be asking is, without any experience, how do I get a job? So you're nodding your head. So part of that, when I used to hire, I like bringing in young people, and I think there's probably a lot of other people that do, because you're interested, you're passionate. Demonstrate that. So when you write a cover letter, you're writing a cover letter to Geospectrum, find out what Geospectrum's about. Put things in your cover letter that specifically answer to the job posting and to your interest in the job posting. And when I would interview, and again, I think I'm not the only person in the room that would do this, when you're interviewing for entry level, you're interested in attitude and aptitude. So show the interest, show that you've got the aptitude to learn to be able to take it to the next level, show that you understand that even though you're an electrical engineer or biologist or whatever you might be, that you also understand that it's a multidisciplinary problem. Part of getting those ideas, I guess, is coming to meetings like this, but if you demonstrate that, it'll help you stand out. Because you're right, it can be tough. I remember the first person I hired when I started my company, I had 100 resumes to go through. I was picking one person. So you gotta find a way to stand out. That would be my recommendation. That would work with me anyway.
Can I add one thing to that, Chair?
Yep, of course.
And this is on the topic of paid internships. Through that, we really see sort of a tendency towards not-for-profit research and development corporations, which IORE is one. There are several within at Dow. There's a really big one on the West Coast called MITAX. And if, even as an undergraduate student or as a graduate student, if you can, you and whoever you're working with can come up with an idea that you think might be a really good project. Well, what they're looking for is an industry that might be interested in co-funding, and they'll come up with sort of half the money, and industry comes up with the other half. And I think those are good opportunities. Perhaps you folks can speak to it more than I. But if you come and say, well, and actually I've got an idea of how I can fund that, that makes all the difference in the world. And there seem to be more and more opportunities like that that you can take advantage of.
Right. Did you want to add? Yeah, go ahead.
So certainly the co-op program that I took part in during my master's research was essential in me identifying the applicability of my research for industry issues. If you do have kind of a research focus that's quite academic, if you can look beyond your interest level and identify where that research might be applied, that might start to help you identify potential career paths. Also, many of the programs that in the aquaculture industry, many of the research programs often engage students in kind of a work term slash research role. So that's certainly helped to give individuals both the research experience, but also identify where in the industry those things can be applied. And finally, just the last point that I've noticed in many of the students that I've hired and many of the entry-level positions that I've staffed, and also I think with regards to some of the research funding, I know that a lot of these things are highly competitive, and I would encourage individuals that don't have perhaps the highest academic standing to not be discouraged, to still apply for roles and apply for research funding and apply in particular for industry partnerships, because oftentimes it's individuals that have experienced, in some cases, failure in certain areas. So if your marks haven't been the greatest in some areas, but you've, you know, finished those courses and you've excelled in other areas, sometimes that is an indicator of that adaptability that is really necessary in an industry-focused research program.
Great, thank you. And even to follow along from that, I think Joy made a great point around, you know, your cover letter. I think one of the worst inventions was sort of the template cover letter, because people sort of follow this format and think, there, I filled it in and therefore it's going to go in. Speaking as someone who has seen hundreds and probably thousands of cover letters come across my desk, I look for something that makes it stand out. It's not the longest letter. It's something that shows me that they've done a little bit of research and they've, you know, they know a little bit about me. Maybe they've commented on something that's happened recently with the company or in the news. Something that shows me that, oh, they've done a little more. They're not just sort of putting a new name at the top of this cover letter and sending out 20 of them to 20 different companies. That's one way that I can kind of go through, and it helps me to pull out who is really showing an interest. You know, on paper you can get 30 grads across your desk who all look exactly the same in terms of their resume. They all have the same kind of experience, the same kind of education. You're looking for what makes them stand out. And also, as Joe was saying, you know, you're looking for sort of that attitude. I'm a big believer that, you know, assuming everyone comes in with the same sort of basic education, that you can teach the rest of it on the job, but you can't teach attitude and you can't teach curiosity. And so you're looking for people who are already bringing that to the table. I'd also like to say that in my role at IORE, what I'm doing is actually leading a national research study looking at workforce development in the national marine industry. And so I'm actually looking at gaps and opportunities in the education system, in the K-12 and also in the post-secondary education system. And I will say that a lot of the programs, I've recently been out west, and a lot of the programs at the universities and at the colleges and also out here in the East Coast are really building into them a practical element. And if it's not a co-op, a lot of them are at least building in a capstone project, which builds that connection to industry, which is really important, because then you also get that feedback loop with industry that, are we producing the graduates that you want? Are they coming out with the skills that you're looking for? And so those are really important programs to be looking for if you are looking at a next step for your education. Okay, what other questions do you have?
Hi, I'm Denise DeLong with the Halifax Partnership, and I wanted to thank, if he's here, Chris Burke, for inviting me today. And this is related to the question. We work in our connector program with new grads from Dalhousie and from the NSCC, and also with experienced, more senior level engineers. And one of the questions, if we believe that networking and actually having face-to-face contact with companies and people that you want to work with is important, and I personally, having lived out west, know that it's very important in Halifax. I guess I'd like to know where, other than a great event like this, can students engage in these kinds of, well, either panel level discussions or even more sort of informal discussions, so that companies can get a sense of their aptitude, their attitude, and there's some information exchange.
Anyone want to take that one?
I'll give it a kick.
Great.
I think the institutes that are in the various universities and colleges around IORE do have some really great opportunities for this to happen. I'd also recommend the professional institutions that are around, whether it's engineering or it's science, accounting, whichever. Most of the people in, from industry, at least, will have people attending those events. So just get out and circulate. So there will be a, at least a representation of people from the ocean technology industries. That even just the pure, more pure, well, call the pure institutions that support your own profession, the individual professions. But they are precious and far and few between to really, really hit something like this. This is an extraordinary environment right here with the IORE. It's a great initiative and very important for the critical mass of what we're trying to build here.
Thanks. Oh, we have another comment.
I would say also any of the special talks that are given on, being given in different subjects, whether they're on campus or at some of the other institutions, BIO, et cetera. I know one of the professors from here, it was a year and a half, 2 years ago, gave a talk on underwater acoustic modems and his research into that at BIO. And a lot of those are open to the public. I was there and there was various other people from industry there to see the talk. So if as students, if, you know, it depends what your schedule is like and that, I know maybe getting over to BIO from here isn't probably the easiest if you don't have a car, but any of these other special talks that are put on, even if they're not at the school, a lot of them are open to the public and they're all going to have industry representatives there to hear what's going on. So that's another chance to meet people and see what the interests are.
Yeah, and I'd also like to say that at the IORE, we are real connectors. I mean, that's kind of our purpose. And so if you do hear about other kind of talks and other events like this that we might not be aware of, let us know and we can certainly get it on our website as well and get a blurb out so that people know what else is up and coming. Did you have a comment as well?
For my industry, you know, we're business connectors such as, you know, the Sea Farmers Conference. There's a good opportunity for students to attend that and learn about the aquaculture industry and the province. I know some, you know, provincial government agencies like InnovaCorp, they have a thing called Business Over Breakfast. Once a month, that's a good opportunity to learn about business opportunities, and a lot of it is oceans focused. So any events that you know, you could connect with potential businesses that may be in the industry you're interested in, you know, there's a good opportunity to connect there, and most of them are free. So.
Thanks. And also, this is our first event like this, so I do welcome your feedback as well. Send me an email if you have suggestions on future events that are similar to this, who else you would like to see on a panel. I think we have another question back there. Yeah? Do we? No? Oh, I thought I saw a hand. What are we doing here for time? No final questions? Well, then why don't we wrap things up, and feel free to stick around for another little bit, have another drink, and chat with the panelists. Grab them if you can. And thanks very much to our panelists for your time here today. I really appreciate that. And thanks also to everyone else for coming out and for giving up some of your afternoon to be here with us and to support the network. Have a great afternoon.